Well, this is one of the first films where we have a Universal logo that's going to be followed by a Paramount logo later on.
And I was so surprised the first time I saw that Universal logo on this film.
It was nice to have the Paramount logo back and the VistaVision logo. This is Bob Harris, by the way. Jim, you should probably say hello so that people know what your voice sounds like.
Well, this is Jim Katz, and together we have been working over 2 years to restore Vertigo, the version which you'll be watching.
And we're joined by Herbie Coleman, whose credit on the film as associate producer, but in reality today would have been considered the producer of Vertigo.
What did associate producer mean then, Herbie?
Oh, back in those days, there were very few associate producers. Paramount had two. I was one, and Paul Nathan, who worked with Hal Wallace, was the other. In those days, an associate producer title was a title almost equal to producer. And I was the actual producer on the film. There was no other producer.
Now, you also produced North by Northwest?
North by Northwest and A Man Who Knew Too Much and The Wrong Man and others.
Why did Hitchcock take the producer's credit?
He didn't take it. You never saw his credit as producer on this film.
No, he takes a director credit.
Right, that's all.
Herbie, do you remember anything about any early discussions about the Saul Bass credits? Anything special about the credit sequence?
No, the credit discussion came in after the picture was finished. During the filming of the picture, we never discussed the main title with having Saul Bass do it.
He was a sort of designer for hire, wasn't he, at that point? I mean, he was working at Paramount?
No, he had his own offices, Saul Bass & Associates, I think was the name of it, up on Sunset Boulevard. And he was a very well-known, what do you call
graphic
him?
Graphic designer.
Graphic designer, yes. He did the Lowry's restaurant, for instance. One was one of his logos. One of the first ones I knew about.
Now, this was the, I believe, the only film that Bernard Herrmann composed for which he did not conduct the score. Can you tell us a little bit about what happened with the original recordings on that? And
well, the ASCAP called a strike just before we were ready to start the recording the music, and Bernard Herrmann, we call Benny, was restricted from conducting the orchestra any place in the world. So I had to take the picture first to London, and then from London, after they joined the ASCAP strike too, I had to go to Vienna to complete the scoring. For 4 days, estimate, I was gone for 6 weeks.
And part of it was in stereo. London section was in stereo, wasn't it?
Right, yeah. Uh-huh.
And Vienna, it was in monaural.
That's right.
Well, the rooftop sequence, the first couple of shots are long shots in their production photography.
Right,
and then we're going to go to a number of process shots, which were rather the bane of our existence during the restoration. Hitchcock loved process shots. There were about 1,400 feet of them in the film, and the negative was not fully exposed and faded differently than the rest of the film, which created lots of problems.
And I shot all of those process shots myself, everything.
And those were all shot in VistaVision also, weren't they?
In VistaVision. As a matter of fact, in the car, I've had two VistaVision cameras shooting forward and shooting back at the same time so I'd get the traffic in perspective.
That shot that looking down in the alley, you said that was the only real perspective. What did you mean by that?
I meant that what you see of the people down below, the rest of it's all painting.
So the buildings are a painting.
Yeah, mm-hmm. You can see that people stay away from the buildings.
You know, we've had questions, people wondering how Jimmy Stewart actually did get down off that building.
I have no idea either. We never tried to explain that.
One of the interesting things that we found during the restoration was that the color, which hasn't been seen in 38 years, started to come through and show itself again. Midge being yellow and Jimmy Stewart being brown. And
you mean because of the time?
Yes, well, because of the the fading of the negative elements and the production of dupes and things like that. You keep getting further and further away from the original negative, and you keep losing things.
Well, what you people did with it was just absolutely marvelous and so beautiful.
I think we've got to give them the $10 now, Jim.
Yeah, I think so. Herbie, why is that background in Midge's apartment? You know, everybody thinks it's a black and white still.
It's a painted backing.
Well, the background out of Midge's apartment on the camera sheets, if I'm not mistaken, says it was a plate shot in cloudy weather or in dull weather.
Yeah, some of it was.
What was it like working with Jimmy Stewart on the film?
Wonderful. He was one of the easiest actors to work with in all my years in the film business.
I have acrophobia. I wake up at night seeing that man fall from the roof and I try to reach out.
Was he involved in the picture right from the start or?
Oh, yes. When we talked about making this picture from what I can't pronounce the French title. It was always Jimmy Stewart. There wasn't anybody else ever considered for the part.
Well, the original title was From Among the Dead, was it not?
Yeah, in English, yes.
In English, yes. I can't pronounce the French title either.
What did Lou Wasserman mean today when he was saying that they were, well, you said that they were holding up the production for a while. What did they mean by that?
Oh, he must have been talking about all the things that happened that caused the holdup. Like when at the beginning, before we started, we postponed the picture for 9 weeks because Gloria Stewart, or Jimmy's wife, wanted him to have a vacation before we started the picture, and then there was Hitchcock's two operations. And
well, I don't think he was married at that point.
That's what Lou said, but I thought he was.
Well, and was he instrumental in getting Kim Novak involved? Or
who, Lou?
No, Jimmy Stewart.
No, he didn't. Jimmy didn't even know anything about it until Lou made the deal at Columbia.
Can you explain that deal a little bit? Do you remember it?
Well, when Vera Miles turned up pregnant, and Hitch was in the hospital and couldn't discuss business with him, Lou and I had a conversation, and Lou went looking for a new star. And Kim Novak was his first and our first choice, and so he had no problem getting Harry Cohen to agree to a loan out Kim Novak for Jimmy Stewart.
And they had to do a picture first, though, didn't they? Have to do a picture at Columbia?
No, no. Jimmy did the picture for Columbia after this.
And that was Bell, Book, and Candle.
I don't remember. Was that the picture?
No, for Richard Quine.
Mm-hmm.
We were engaged once, though, weren't we?
3 whole weeks.
Yeah, good old college days. But you were the one that called off the engagement, you remember? I'm still a
bit. Now, Samuel Taylor was the one who introduced the character of Midge.
Yeah, there was no character like Midge in the book, but Sam realized that Jimmy had to have somebody to talk to rather than just spill it out on his own. So he came up with this character.
And how did Barbara Bel Geddes get? Well, how was she cast in this?
Well, she was the very first choice.
Was she a client as well of?
I don't know whether she was or not, but I suspect she was.
Because she was quite a well-known Broadway actress at the time.
Oh yeah, lovely person to work with too.
You know, we should probably mention that the film was shot in the process called VistaVision.
Right.
Which was Paramount's process, which began in 1954 with White Christmas.
Right.
And it was a double-frame process, two frames of 35 millimeter.
Going through horizontally.
Correct, from right to left. And the quality of the film that came through was quite extraordinary. And when VistaVision prints were made, you then had a soundtrack along the upper edge of the film, which ran at twice the speed of normal sound, which literally gave you motion picture high fidelity in both picture and track. And because it was photographed in this process, we were able to convert it literally frame by frame over to 65 millimeter for the restoration.
I didn't know that.
Yeah, we had to make all new elements from Vista, basically taking it on a shot-by-shot basis and creating corrections in gamma or contrast ratios for basically every shot in the film to try and bring back color and bring back contrast, because the yellow layer was quite faded by the time we got the negative. It was actually quite faded by 1983 when Universal got the film elements.
Well, how in the world were you able to restore it?
Well, the one thing we did was we tried to find as many color references in the frame as possible. We had no idea what the yellow was in Barbara Bel Geddes' sweater, and what the yellow was on the stepladder, or what color the jaguar was, or what color the some of Judy's clothes were. And we tried to find as much as we could from either in some instances a costume, in some instances the jaguar riding.
By the way, it should be mentioned that as we dissolve from Midge's apartment to the exterior of the shipyard, you do see Hitchcock going across the screen. And that's his appearance.
Herbie, did you know when he was going to do that? Did you know that was the shot in front of the shipyard?
Yes, I did.
Now, was he nervous directing himself, or did you direct him?
No, I directed that.
So you directed Hitchcock's appearance in Vertigo.
Right.
Now, was that spontaneous, or when you got the script, did he say, that's the scene I'm going to...
I don't remember that being in the script. Those things are usually thought up during the production. At one time, I tried to get him to be in a wheelchair as a nun, but he wouldn't quite go for that.
I think he was in a wheelchair in what, Topaz or Torn Curtain, one of those films.
Yeah, he wouldn't appear as a nun, though.
With a baby on his lap, as I recall. Yeah. Now, did you do a lot of takes? Was he a good actor?
One take,
and he walked at the correct speed. And
yep, for instance, the appearance in North by Northwest, where he caught the boy, he couldn't get aboard the bus.
Mm-hmm.
That was one take. No, it was two takes.
But did he understand his character? And
nobody had to tell Hitch anything. Just timing.
What did he say? What does he say after he does his take? I mean, did he make some comment, or was he?
He was just another actor.
Can you tell us something about the set in the shipbuilding office?
In this particular thing?
Yes.
Well, this set was one of the most expensive sets. It really wasn't necessary to spend as much as we spent on this set. There are seven walls on two levels with process plates out of every window. And we had to move the sets around, of course, switch it around to get it in front of the screen. Took a long time, cost a lot of money for this particular set.
A lot of the sets had ceilings in them, which was sort of unusual, wasn't it?
No, Hitch liked ceilings.
Do you remember what the budget was on Vertigo?
On Vertigo? No, I don't. I should know it, but I just don't remember.
Well, I wondered whether you'd go back on the job as a special favor to me. I want you to follow my wife. No, it's not that. We're very happily married.
Well, then...
This is Laurent Bouzereau, producer of this commentary, and also a personal friend of Thomas Narsajac, who co-wrote with Pierre Boileau the novel From Among the Dead that inspired the movie Vertigo. The novel was published in France in February 1954, and this was actually the fourth novel that Boileau and Narsajac wrote together. Their collaboration began in 1951, and they wrote together many novels, short stories, plays, radio programs even, original screenplays and adaptations of their own work. In addition to Vertigo, of course, many of their novels were adapted to the screen. Probably the most famous one is Les Diaboliques, directed by Henri-Georges Clouzot in 1955. They also collaborated with Georges Franju on the horror classic Eyes Without a Face in 1960. And now back to Herbert Coleman, Bob Harris, and Jim Katz. I wouldn't know
how. How did Tom Helmore come to pass? Was he the first choice for that part?
No, we looked at other actors. I can't remember who they were, but about four or five other actors.
Do you want to get into that now?
It's quite long and involved talking about various scripts. If you want to do that,
do you want to do an overview on it?
Well, on the selection of the writer, I was absolutely opposed to having Maxwell Anderson do this screenplay because of the problem we had with him on The Wrong Man. He really had lost touch with reality. We had a tough time keeping him the actuality of the events in The Wrong Man, and I was afraid that he would be carried away with the story about this strange woman, you know, what was happening.
Didn't Hitchcock insist, though, that he do this draft?
Well, finally, Hitchcock got tired of me refusing to make a deal for him and had somebody else, I have no idea who it was, make a deal with Irving Lazar and pay the first $35,000, which I never allowed to be charged to the budget, and send him back east to write the screenplay, and Hitch and Alma went up to the ranch up in above Santa Cruz in the redwood trees, and I took Mary Bell, my wife, and I, and then we went on a survey of San Francisco and the Mission, and finally found Mission San Juan Bautista and made a deal with Father Sullivan to use that, because we had to know what mission we were going to use before Maxwell Anderson could really write the sequence.
So how was it decided that San Francisco was going to be the place, location?
It's never had an idea of doing it any place but San Francisco. He first started talking about it, he said, we're going to make San Francisco the locale. And
San Francisco is very happy about that.
So was I. And finally, I came back from where I'd selected San Juan Bautista and the various other locations we needed, including Ernie's restaurant.
Now, Ernie's was a set, always, was it not?
Well, yeah, the interior, yes. And we had a shot on the exterior, just one shot of the exterior of Ernie's restaurant.
So the exterior was production photography?
No, that was actually at Ernie's.
That was at Ernie's.
Mm-hmm.
So what happened, Herbie, when Maxwell Anderson's script came in?
Well, I was back from my location survey, and I received the screenplay. Hitch was up at the ranch. I took one look at the title and wondered, what in the world did Listen Darkling mean? LISTENDARKLING. And I was puzzled about the title, and I sat down and read the thing and couldn't believe it. It didn't even make any sense. I read it a second time. It was even worse. So I called Hitch, and I said, I'm going to send up Anderson's script. He said, well, what about it? I said, Hitch, if I tell you what I think, you'll say, well, I couldn't be fair because I didn't want him in the first place. And I said, Hitch, I'll read you one scene.
Oh, this is, we're watching Kim Novak's.
I can see that. Shall I tell you about this scene now?
Sure. This is one of the great entrances in film history.
He sure took care of his leading ladies and their entrances, didn't he?
I'll tell you about that. The first time we made that scene, Hitch had her turn and look around and had her eyes stop on Jimmy and then continue on, all in one shot without cutting to Jimmy. And after we had done the final editing on the picture, Hitch was leaving for a vacation in Jamaica or someplace in the Virgin Islands, I forgot where it was. He suddenly said to me, he said, you know, we should never have allowed her eyes to stop on Jimmy because an audience might catch on right then there's something between these two people. So he said, what are you going to do about it? I said, are you going to stay and do it? He said, no, I'm going on a vacation. He said, you'll have to get Kim in and redo it. So I got her in, had Bummy put the set up again, and reshot the scene, recut this picture, and then when we were all through, took the picture back to New York and had Hitch come up from where he was on his vacation, and we ran the picture, and everything was going beautifully until we got to that scene of her turning and not letting her eyes stop, and we kept going for about 100 feet, and all of a sudden he said, stop the screen, stop the running. And of course I knew what he was going to say about it. He said to me, what lens did you use on that retake? I said, a 3-inch lens. He said, didn't you know I used a 2-inch? I said, yes, I did. He said, why didn't you use a 2-inch? And I said, well, because when I came on the set, I didn't have enough backing. Because the red backing from Ernie's restaurant had been destroyed. We only had enough to get it, cover the background with the 3-inch lens. Did he complain about that forever? Because you can see a difference in perspective, you know, between those two lenses.
Now, at Ernie's, you pretty much brought the restaurant down to Los Angeles, didn't you?
Everything. Tablecloths, silverware, china, stemware, and the wall decorations, and Ernest ordered all that beautiful red fabric wall covering for us, all we needed.
One point on the restoration and film fading, as Jimmy walks into this back door, we had a situation in which the negative was extremely faded and everything that was black. When a yellow layer fades, Things that are black and shadow details go a milky blue, and facial highlights go crustacean yellow. So this part of the film is all from black and white separations, which fortunately fit together reasonably well and weren't too dirty.
This is the scene now, when this door opens, that everybody is testing the color in their own minds. They're saying, what in the hell did these guys do?
Oh, really?
This is the test, yeah, this is the test. This, and Marty Scorsese, when he saw it, he said, well, what's the flower shop look like? What's the flower shop look like? And
who was this and asked that?
Martin Scorsese, the director, when we ran some reels for him in New York. And I think it's the first real indication of, I think, the success we've had in bringing the color back to the picture.
Although this shot is faded. It's, there's no denying it. And we went to the black and white separations on that, and they would not register. So the only way to keep the film in large format was to use the original negative and adapt the contrast and work with the color as best as we could.
Well, it looked beautiful in the restoration.
Well, the interesting thing is when people come in to see a restoration, we sort of like to know where they're coming from, whether they think we have to match a new picture, whether it's supposed to look like it did the day it was made, or whether it has to match the standards of movies today. So
that was a problem, wasn't it?
Well, we tried to achieve that without destroying, the spirit in which the picture was made. Now here's Kim going into the mission.
All of the shots of Jimmy driving are all process shots in which the negative had faded.
Right.
But this was interesting here, Herbie, because we had no idea really at first where the fog filters were used. And that obviously affects the timing on the film.
And the fading.
And the fading, right.
And you didn't have the camera reports available.
Yeah,
we had full camera reports.
Mm-hmm. Oh,
fortunately, Paramount's files and Hitchcock's records were all donated to the Academy of Motion Picture Arts and Sciences, the Margaret Herrick Library, which has always been extremely helpful to us, as has the archive there. But we had the camera reports, we had daily continuity reports.
Well, that did help you then, didn't it?
Production reports. Oh, yes, because it showed us which takes were using fog filters, whether they're half fogs or quarter fogs or no fogs, whatever.
At the bridge sequence, we're going back and forth with halves and fulls and no fogs, and it was a tremendous help. In fact, I think they were Peggy Robertson's notes, and they were meticulous, and they were really a tremendous tremendous help to us. Yeah, Peggy Robertson was the
script
supervisor on this picture, and eventually became Hitchcock's personal assistant, if I'm not mistaken. Is that right, Herbie?
That's right. She was her main job was in casting, because she saw every picture was ever once he put her in that job. She saw every picture was released anywhere, I guess, and had complete files on them, and could suggest anybody, for any part.
The other thing that was extremely valuable to us were George Tomasini, the editor's notes on the mix, the sound mix, along with Hitchcock's dubbing notes, and mm-hmm. we made tremendous use of those. In fact, interestingly enough, as you well know, there was no rock and roll in those days. You had to do a pass on the reel and make whatever changes you wanted, and then if there were subsequent changes, you had to go through the reel again. And we always figured it was never 100%, because that moment was going to come when it wasn't worth going through the reel and the reel again and just moving on. But we had some meticulous notes on conceptual notes from Hitchcock and George Tomasini, which not only said pretty much what they wanted, which was in some instances less is more, but in other instances, a very specific feel that the reel should have. And we tried to keep to that as much as we possibly can with the materials that we had on hand.
Now, the problem with the sound was that the only surviving composite track was a used 35mm print with a rather scratched optical track on it, which did not yield wonderful results.
Where'd you find that?
That was on one of Hitchcock's prints that came over to Universal that had been in storage. But it was a regular release print. The original tracks, all of the original mags had been junked in 1967, with the exception of the music, the original music, which resided in Paramount's library, albeit rotting, But they saved it. They apparently had no more rights to it, so they didn't have a budget to preserve it. And
they made Paramount.
Paramount, but fortunately they didn't junk it. And once we found those, we realized that you know, the public really had to hear them as we were hearing them, because they were extraordinarily beautifully recorded. And, I mean, the music was just unbelievable. Herbie, we have the portrait, as you know, of Vera Miles as Carlotta hanging in our office at the moment. But how many portraits were there, and can you give us a brief history of the various portraits of Carlotta and why they happened?
This portrait was to cause us more trouble than any other prop in the whole picture. Hitch wanted me to have the portrait painted in England, but I wanted it done in Rome, so I had a color photograph made of Vera Miles and sent instructions to the Rome office to do this painting exactly as the photograph was, except to put an aristocratic face on the woman. And we waited, and finally the painting came. It was not usable because they had hired somebody for 15 cents, I think, to do the painting. So then we tried England, and that came back. It was almost as bad. And then the studio suggested there was a painter that did a lot of studio work. And I don't remember his name, but I said, well, let me see some of his work. And his work was very good, so I made a deal with him.
He was in Hollywood, wasn't he?
Yes, he lived in Hollywood, a man in his late 60s. Met with him, talked to him, told him the whole story, and he started the painting. Then one day he said he must meet Vera Miles to keep on going, and unfortunately I agreed to it. She went to see him, and finally he said, I have the painting ready, and brought it over, and it was a beautiful painting of Vera Miles. So here we were.
So that must be the one we have in our office.
Evidently, yes. I haven't seen that one.
Is he the one who fell in love with her while he was painting it?
Yeah, he had fallen in love with her, and that, of course, destroyed that one. And then I remembered the painter who did the all of the paintings for The Trouble with Harry, and I got in touch with him, and he did the final portrait we used. And at the moment, I can't think of his name, but I'll give it to you.
Was it John Farron?
Yeah, John Farron.
And he did the one that's in the film now that we see Kim looking at in the museum.
Right.
Now, did he also do the dream sequence?
Yes, I think he did all those, all the paintings he did.
Getting back to the sound, once we found the original music, we realized that we had to use them. And the only composite track that was available was a used 35mm optical print, which held good sound for 1958, but for 1996 standards, it really wasn't there. And the studio sound department pulled out the dialogue as well as they could, separated it, made a stem of it, and then created all new Foley, which are the clothing rustlings and body sounds and all new effects, and went to a point of finding a 1957 Carmen Ghia and recording that engine and the DeSotos and all the 50s cars, an analog sound from a police officer's revolver from the 50s. So the sound is all very authentic, although newly recorded, and there were some effects that we were able to use from the original because they were clean.
This was, in fact, an interesting point as we screened the film around the country, because the purists came to us and said, well, how can you restore a film and redo a soundtrack? And basically we tell them that the alternative was not to hear any sound at all, or to hear a mono track from 1958, which is...
with scratches and bumps and holes in it.
Then the picture would have been finished.
Well, the soundtrack pretty much was finished. We used part of in the mission sequence. The sound was taken from a 1958 Spanish track, and that's the only sound that was the only music that was not actually taken from the tracks that we found at Paramount, the original.
Right. When we attempted to run that particular track, the oxide just dropped off it. So there was literally nothing there. There was nothing left of it. All of the original music tracks were full of vinegar syndrome. They were rotten.
In fact, Herbie, when we found them, they were in these tin cans, square cans, and we brought them up to Warner Hollywood Studios, where we tried to transfer them. In fact, we were holding the mag track against the sound head, transferring it onto a 24 track, and as we it was going through the machine, the emulsion was peeling off.
Not in your hands.
Right, just coming right off the film, and we knew that this was it. We had one chance to do this, and we managed to get about 90% of the music, but it was music with a clarity that has never really been heard on the film.
Herbie, what place did Alma Ravel, Hitch's wife, had in the productions? I mean, she was there guiding at all times, really, wasn't she?
Hitch always consulted Alma on everything they were doing in a film. She had great respect for her. You know, she was originally a script clerk. She was his script clerk when he was his first pictures.
Well, she was in the business before him, wasn't she?
I don't know whether she was or not. I've never discussed that with her. But he always discussed his scripts with her. And as a matter of fact, she would quite often write on his, toward the end even, she would write, rewrite things on his scripts.
What was her opinion of that Maxwell Anderson script?
The same as mine.
And what happened after that Maxwell Anderson script?
Yeah, how did Sam Taylor get involved?
Well, first after Maxwell Anderson, I refused to make any future payments to him. That became a problem with Irving Lazar, not worth getting into. And then I told Hitch about having settled on Mission San Juan Bautista. He said, why don't you and Maribel come up to the ranch and Maribel can stay with Alma while you and I go and look at the location you've chosen.
Maribel was your wife.
My wife, uh-huh. And so we drove up to, we flew up to San Francisco and then took the car from there up to the ranch. And when I arrived at the ranch, he said to me, the boys have found your new writer, Herbie. And I said, who's that? He said, Alec Koppel. Well, I knew one thing about Koppel. I knew of his... I think it was called The Captain's Paradise. It's a screenplay that he had written. So we thought we had the right man for that, but he didn't quite come up to the level we wanted. And so Hitch was really despairing, and he decided to call Kay Brown in New York, who was a wonderful literary agent. I think she was one of Lou Wasserman's mm-hmm. people. And she instantly, when he told her the story, suggested Sam Taylor. And... we told Kay if he's available, make a deal to send him out. So he came out, and boy, did we have the right man.
You know, we're in the Argosy bookstore sequence now. Do you recall anything about the lighting change in the sequence?
No.
Because people come to us in the theaters, and they think that the projection lamp is going out or wonder what's going on.
Well, the film's faded. We have all sorts of explanations.
As the story gets more and more depressing, the picture gets darker and darker as if a storm is brewing.
She came from somewhere small to the south of the city. Some say from a mission settlement. Young, yes, very young.
What was Robert Burke's role in the films? I mean, how much did he have to say about the look of the film?
When you say the look of the film, do you mean the overall...
The overall concept, lighting, color?
That was entirely left up to him. And he was... one of the very top photographers in all my years in the business. He was one of the very top ones. He had a facility of being able to make the actors and actresses look the part. I don't know how in the world he did it, but he was the best at it.
Hitchcock had a pretty loyal team around him all the time, didn't he? He had Burks, he had Tomasini, he had Bumstead.
Right.
Was this
and Coleman.
And Coleman,
there was a guy by the name of Coleman around, I remember.
Yeah, it sounds like a double play combination, doesn't it? Burks to
Tomasini to Bumstead to Coleman.
That's a triple play.
Yeah.
Well, when I went out to Warner Brothers, and we finally, I was settled as Hitch's assistant on Rear Window, he said, I'm going to bring with me when I come to Paramount, Bob Burks, the cameraman, and a man by the name of Schur as the operator, and Lenny South as camera assistant, and I'll leave the rest of the selection of the staff to you. And so I selected all the people that worked with Hitch from then on. And one of my best selections, of course, was George Tomasini.
The unit, as it worked, did Hitchcock have a lot of influence on Henry Bumstead's sets, or did Henry come up with ideas? Because when we spoke to him, he came to our office with drawings, Hitchcock's drawings and his drawings, and they seemed to conceptualize the sets together. I mean, was that a collaborative effort, or was Henry pretty much left on his own?
After the initial discussions, Bummy was left almost completely on his own. Those drawings you're talking about, I can't remember those. Hitch used to make little sketches of this.
Those are the ones.
Mm-hmm. You know, but that was not done for information for the art director. He left that entirely up to the art directors.
So the whole concept of Midge's apartment being the way it was, with sort of an artist's loft look to it, was all Henry.
The one ideal thing for the people who worked with Hitch was the fact that the screenplays were always detailed, and it was pretty easy for them to bring that to life, having read the screenplay. The art director, of course, was a little different because they had to get busy on it long before the screenplays were ready. But Hitch always had in his head the entire story, every move, every camera, everything. As a matter of fact, on Rear Window, he had John Michael Hayes set at a typewriter, and Hitch walked around the office dictating the entire screenplay to him. The only thing he didn't do was write the dialogue.
You know, an interesting story that Bummy told me in Chicago recently was that there was a sort of a lull on the set of Vertigo, and Hitch was sitting in a corner with his arms folded, and he was sort of thinking and not saying anything to anyone, and he went up to him, and Bummy went up to him and said, What are you thinking about, Hitch? And he says, I'm thinking about my next picture. And he said he had already made Vertigo in his mind. He already knew exactly what it was going to look like. Was that pretty accurate?
What picture did he say that happened on?
On Vertigo.
Oh, Vertigo, of course. He had everything in his own mind before we ever started, long before we started the picture.
We have the magic disappearing ice cubes in this scene now.
Yeah, you see, this is in the men's club, the Union Club, I think it is, in San Francisco, which was also a set, if I'm not mistaken.
Oh, yes, it was. Now, what do you mean about the missing ice cubes?
No, watch those ice cubes.
Well, here there are two glasses with ice cubes in them, and Elster and Scotty are talking, and we're going
to
see...
We're going to cut to a...
We're going to cut to a
an
shot.
Alternate angle in a moment.
I've heard you mention that before, and I couldn't figure out what you were talking about. I could see the ice cubes in those other two glasses.
Mm-hmm.
Well, now they're gone.
Well, and did you ask Peggy Robinson how she let that happen?
Yeah, you see there's that empty glass there, Herbie, with no...
Well, that's Peggy Robinson's fault, you know.
Well, we're going to have to go out
we're gonna have to
point
words
that out
with her. That's,
yep.
Actually, we could digitally replace them, but that wouldn't be true to the film. And it would only cost about as much as the entire restoration.
I dug out the rest for myself, yeah.
Well, why wouldn't she tell her daughter?
Natural fear. Her grandmother went insane, took her own life. Her blood is in Madeline.
Boy, I need this.
That scene in the men's club that we just saw was the first time that Elster sucks Scotty into the plot, into his scheme. And as was the case in most Hitchcock pictures, another innocent bites the dust, another innocent is involved in something that they have no idea of or have any idea of the big picture, the grand plan.
One of the interesting things that we found when we went up to San Francisco to... run the film in April and then open it not long ago, was that there are Vertigo tours going on, and people actually go to the museum and the Mission Dolores and other locations expecting to find Carlotta's tombstone and the portrait of Carlotta. And they go to the San Juan Batista expecting to see the tower, which never existed.
Right.
Herbie, what happened with that, with the tower?
The tower? That was all a painting, of course.
But did you find that location?
Yes, I did, and my daughter Judy was responsible for it. Hitch liked the Carmel Mission, but when I went to see the Carmel Mission, it was on a busy street and didn't have the 1890 feel about it. And Judy had told me about the Mission San Juan Bautista, so we went from there right to see San Juan Bautista, and that was absolutely perfect for the
picture. Here comes the money shot in the film, of course.
This is the signature shot, Herbie. Was this Hitch's plan? I mean, was this shot under the Golden Gate Bridge, the one? I mean, was it given more attention in the planning, or was it just another day?
No, this was very important to Hitch, and this location was always in his mind. He knew exactly, and had told Sam Taylor this is where he wanted the scene to play. It described the actual shots he was going to have made.
Now, is this a stand-in, or is that Kim? In the long shots.
In the long shot. She was in the long shots except for the jump.
So then a stand-in jumped into a net or something?
A double.
Well, it had to be something because there's nothing but rocks
and water.
Yeah, I don't know what they had down there because I wasn't there on that day when they shot this.
Now, here we are with the fog filters. Here we're on a full fog filter here looking at the bridge, and we're going to cut over to...
This is without a fog filter.
This is without one, and now we're up to Jimmy with a full fog looking at her, back to the master shot here of the bridge.
These are all with fogs.
Right.
Now this is without a fog on there as he comes running in.
Back into a fog filter.
Yeah, and it's been written
and
that...
And jumps into the studio tank.
That's right.
Well, it's been written that Hitchcock used the fog filter to bring the audience in and out of reality. Was there any truth to that? Did he ever discuss that with you?
No, never discussed it with me. Probably discussed it with Bob Burks. But matter of fact, I didn't even know if they were using a fog filter on those.
Now, on the 70mm, you can see that huge bruise on Kim Novak's knee, which was not visible in 35. Now, the interesting thing here is that it's an earlier point where she's gone through this and she's aware of this plot with Elster and is actually sort of... Bringing him along, you know, she's sort of duping him.
Yeah, of course, but the audience doesn't know that.
Yeah, Herbie, the exterior of Scotty's apartment, that was a production shot, was it not, in San Francisco?
The exterior of what?
Of Scotty's apartment with the red door?
Yes, that was.
And then all of the interiors are on the sound stages.
Yes, on the stage at the studio.
You see this shot with the underwear hanging up? And
there's nothing recognizable in there.
We found in the notes that the Legion of Decency said they did not want any recognizable female undergarments hanging on the line. So even though we know that he's pulled her out of the bay, taken her back to his apartment, taken her clothes off, and put her into bed, the audience isn't supposed to really get that. Because there's no clothes hanging on the line.
No, we wanted the audience to get that.
Well, this is what we call the deer in the headlight shot of Kim as she turns around. But the Legion of Decency was doing everything they could to remove any signs of what was actually going on.
Yeah, they have a problem those days.
Now he hands her the robe, and today she'd probably say, I don't need that.
Yep.
Yeah, Herbie, how did the censorship actually work at that point? Did you have to submit scripts?
Yeah, before you started shooting, you had to let them read the screenplay.
Some of the notes are hilarious.
Well, Herbie, do you want to talk a bit about Hitch preferring to work on sound stages than location?
No, we never had a problem with Hitch about whether we'd shoot it on location or in the studio. We only moved things into the studio that were impossible to do on location.
But on Vertigo, I mean, most of the picture was shot in a studio,
as much as we could, because it cost money, you know, be on location. And
what was the situation with Wreck of the Merry Deer and Vertigo?
Well, I came into the studio one morning, and lying on my desk was the book called The Wreck of the Merry Deer. And when it came in later, it looked at this book lying untouched on my desk and said, aren't you going to read it? I said, I know that story already, because I read it a year ago, and my son came home with it and wanted to make a film of it. But it's impossible to make a film of that. The whole book is on storms at sea with an old freighter, sailboats, rowboats, people swimming in the ocean. It's impossible. You have to build everything on the set, on rockers. It would take forever to do it. And that's when we decided not to do the picture. He said, well, I'll go out to Metro and tell them the story, which became North by Northwest, an idea he'd had in mind for a long time.
What was the original title on North by Northwest, Herbie?
The Man on Lincoln's Nose. And
how did the title for Vertigo come about? How many titles did you go through?
Sam Taylor came up with that title. I can't remember how many.
Yeah, what
time would you normally start shooting, and how would Hitchcock sets work?
It was always, of course, very quiet and very no problems, because problems were solved long before everyone on the set to make it. Everybody knew exactly how a scene was to be shot because it was all in the screenplay, the movements, the camera movements, the mood, and everything was written in the screenplay. Do you have a screenplay of Hitch's available?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
If you read it very carefully, you'll see that it's all written in.
Did that take away any spontaneity, any ideas that anybody came up with on the day? I mean, was there room for things like that?
Very few things were ever brought up on the set. Hitch was—he expected the actors to interpret the scenes, because we hired people that he knew he'd seen pictures of what scenes they had done, to trust them, and there was very little direction on the set.
And he never went to dailies, did he?
Nope. I went to dailies all the time. He never went to dailies.
Any reason why he never went to the dailies? I mean, did he ever explain that to you?
No, never questioned it, though, because I guess he trusted George Tomasino, the editor, and myself.
Wondering about?
Oh, you like it too?
Yes.
Samuel Taylor, co-screenwriter.
It didn't take me very long to write the screenplay, but it took a great deal of time doing the preliminaries. The talking took time, and Hitchcock and I discovered immediately that we liked to talk. And we would sit and talk for hours, and sometimes sit and not talk for times. Hitchcock would always say, well, we're letting the engine idle. And we would just sit quietly, sometimes for half an hour at a time, and then pick up again. We did an awful lot of talking before I did any writing, except for the first scene, of course, which because by the time I had arrived in Los Angeles, I knew that I wanted to create that character of Midge, because I knew that the story would never make any sense unless it had some attachment to reality and humanity, and it had to have somebody who was not involved in the fantasy. And I wrote that scene very quickly. I told him I was going to and explained why. He said, go ahead. And I wrote it, gave it to him. He said, fine. And from then on, we were off. But there was an awful lot of time spent in just fooling around. Hitchcock suggested that I go to San Francisco and look at all the scenery, and which was fine. And also to... he wanted me to scout a few places that he hadn't quite yet picked. And we went to San Francisco for days, and we went down to San Juan Bautista, and that was very exciting. As soon as I saw that stable, I knew what I was going to write. But I don't remember that it took that long. I write fast, and I'm sure the screenplay didn't take very long. But hanging around took long. That was the thing. And when you're with Hitchcock, you do hang around, because it's fun. The important thing about that whole time was how much fun we had. That's the thing I remember most. We really had a wonderful time writing that story. The great fun was being with Hitchcock and talking about the story and talking about the people. But the emotional impact for me came when I was alone writing. After all, Hitchcock and I would sit and talk all morning, let's say, usually at the house on Bellagio Road. And we'd have lunch, and then I would go back to the studio, or sometimes we both would go back to the studio, and I'd go into my office and write. And the writing was where the emotional impact came. The fun came in the talk. But when I sat down to write, I became aware immediately. I think it was all triggered by my invention of the character of Midge. I discovered that there were emotions there, human emotions, that the story had never hinted at. And as I wrote, it went deeper and deeper, and I was enjoying it more and more, because I suddenly found I was writing about two human beings. You see, this picture is only about three people. Hitchcock always fills his film with so much humanity and so much artistry that it seems sometimes as though there's a great, great panorama of people. But actually, this is a story about two people. And the third, the observer. And you cannot tell that story about those two people unless you have the observer to plant it in reality, to say to the audience, this may seem fantastic, but it's not. It has to do with real people. I assure you, I'm the person who can tell you that. And in writing, I found that I could go deeper and deeper, so that the story of this man became a deeply human story and not just a fantasy of a plot. You see, Hitchcock believed that when a screenplay was finished, if it was the screenplay he wanted, that the picture was finished. He'd say, well, there it is, picture's done. He said that to me when we finished Vertigo. He said, picture's done. I said, what do you mean? He said, all I have to do is go out on the stage and shoot it, but the picture is done in my mind. It's made. He knew exactly what he wanted, and he didn't change things. He didn't change things. The only time he ever changed things in making a movie was when the script was weak, and he had to. But with Vertigo, he shot what he had. Hitchcock never presumed to add dialogue or change dialogue, or at least never with me. But the scenes came out of the talks. He and I would talk in the morning, and I would write in the afternoon. But he never once said to me, would you rewrite that? Because he knew what the scene was going to be like, and I knew what the scene was going to be like, and the actual conversations, the dialogue, he accepted completely. He liked them. So that we never had any problem about that. I would like to talk about that, the attitude of Hitchcock towards the legitimacy of telling a story. He used to love to use the phrase icebox talk.
Yes,
hello. The thing that I liked best about talking to Hitchcock about problems when you were doing a screenplay was if you raised a problem that didn't seem very important, he'd say, oh, Hitchcock would say, oh, that's icebox talk. After all, people look at a picture and they go home and they start arguing about things they saw, and one of them says, well, I can't quite believe that. And they'd open the icebox and fish around, and while they were eating, they'd talk about that. And that's icebox talk, and he said, that's part of the picture. Now, actually, Hitchcock was rarely off base on those things. You could always find a reason why there was a Hitchcock touch that startled you. And he always had a legitimate reason, or rather an artistic reason for doing it that worked. I never caught him out, never. And if people wanted to argue about a scene in a picture of his, you would find that they were arguing about something that hadn't happened. They'd seen it wrong. He knew what he was doing, always. Hitchcock was awfully good about that sort of thing. There's an old Hollywood phrase, an old Hollywood saying, that the perfect Hollywood story is boy meets girl, boy loses girl, boy gets girl. After all, a play was written with that title, Boy Meets Girl. And here you had a situation that Hitchcock and I both talked about one day as having a lovely irony for us, because we were telling a story of boy meets girl, boy loses girl, boy meets girl again, boy loses girl again. And that rather tickled him in a way. And there's an irony there that we enjoyed, but also it's the basic element of the emotional story.
And now back to Bob Harris, Jim Katz, and Herbert Coleman.
By the way, the marks that you see occasionally in the upper right-hand corner of the frame, as opposed to changeover cues at the end of reels that look like sort of a hatch mark, told a projectionist the lineup of the top of the frame for different aspect ratios.
Really?
Yeah, that's just a note for those folks that are watching.
Well, here we are at the woods, which is supposed to be Muir Woods, but it's not Muir Woods.
No, it's not supposed to be Muir Woods. He wanted to use Muir Woods, but of course you couldn't get in there because the trees are so condensed and so thick and everything. And the department would not allow us in there because the roots of these trees go right along the top of the ground, and it's a lot of traffic to walk around in Muir Woods. It would destroy that redwood, those forests. So we went to Big Basin up in the hills above Santa Cruz. That's where this was done.
Now these are all process shots here.
Well, that was a convenient location for him, wasn't it?
You mean Santa Cruz?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. I knew that location from a picture we made many years before called Forest Rangers.
Yeah, the section of the tree, the original section, is actually in Muir Woods, and this was reproduced on the
Yeah, but we made no shots
stage
in Muir Woods at all.
Right. Mm-hmm. Well, this was actually reproduced on the set.
Yeah, Bummy did this.
Can you tell us a bit more about the tower and how the tower was designed? And you mentioned that your daughter actually found San Juan Bautista.
She told me about this, we had to have a tower because the body had to fall out of a tower. And, of course, I knew the moment I looked at San Juan Bautista that was going to be our location. And the fact that it had no tower was no problem because I knew we could paint it in. And in those days, they had a process. I don't remember the name of the process, but they put a glass in front of the camera and sprayed white on it. Then they threw the camera, the special effects artist cut out the shape of the tower, and then they photographed through the and they painted in the rest
with
of it.
With the matte painting.
Matte painting.
To this day, people still go to San Juan Bautista looking for the tower. You know.
Let me tell you, my wife and there went there after the big earthquake because I wanted to see if it happened. Anything had happened to the San Juan Bautista mission, and I went in, and the lady knew me from past. I'd been there before, and she said to me, "Mr. Coleman, sometimes I wish you'd never made this picture." And I said, "Why?" She said, "We know every time the people who are coming here because of the history of the mission are the ones who are coming here because of your picture." I said, "Well, how do you know that?" She said, "The ones who come here because of the picture say have two questions. Where's the tower and where's the toilet?"
When were you born?
Long ago.
Where? When?
Herbie, Hitchcock's relationship with Bernard Herrmann went on for quite a ways and then ended rather abruptly. Can you discuss that?
He had great respect for Bernard Herrmann, as he should have, as I do. But Hitch, of course, I wasn't with Hitch at the time. The story is secondhand. Hitch told it to me. He had told Benny that he didn't want one of those heavy, dramatic music scores behind this whatever picture it
was. I think
it was
Torn Curtain.
Torn Curtain. And yet, when he went on the stage to record the music, the first phrase he heard was this loud, dramatic score, and he got walked out and never spoke to Benny after that, as far as I know.
What sort of person was he?
It depends on where he was and what he was doing. Away from the scoring, he was very quiet, and unless you got into a discussion of any kind, then he'd begin to scream at you. But he was a very easy man to know and a very easy man to like.
The
musicians had the greatest respect for him.
The score on the restoration is featured.
Tremendous.
And it's almost another star of the film. And this was a very difficult decision that we had to make when we were when we discovered the tracks, the original floor recordings, because we knew at that point that we would have to digitize the dialogue tracks and lose the effects in Foley, and therefore have to recreate them. And we knew that we would hear from the purists, and we knew that it was an important decision, but subsequently we decided to feature the score.
Thank goodness.
And we've been pleased with the reaction of the Vertigo aficionados such as Andy Saris and Kenny Turan and various critics around the country who at least agreed with us in this point. But we're getting beaten up a little bit on the internet over this.
That's one of the reasons I was sorry I didn't get to talk to that music editor from the San Francisco Chronicle, because I was so impressed with what you'd done with the music.
Well, it's a beautiful score, and it's extremely romantic, and there's not much like this around these days, and I think it's really interesting to see how the audiences are reacting, because, you know, we're playing to audiences who don't know how the film's going to end, and we're playing to audiences who only have seen this film with commercials in between or have seen bad prints over the years. So it's really been gratifying to sit in an audience and really hear reactions to music and picture and performance.
In the garden below. It seems to be in Spain. Village in Spain. It clicks off and it's gone.
Well, a portrait. Do you see a portrait?
No.
Hello, my name is Stephen Smith. I'm the author of the book A Heart at Fire Center, The Life and Music of Bernard Herrmann. And for the next few minutes, I'm going to talk about that very important participant in Vertigo, the composer. This was Bernard Herrmann's fourth film with director Alfred Hitchcock, and already theirs had become one of the closest teamings between a director and composer in the history of film. They didn't work together until 1955 on The Trouble with Harry, but it really was Herrmann who created the sound that we now associate with Hitchcock's films, with scores for movies like Psycho, North by Northwest, Marnie, and certainly Vertigo. Since his death in 1975, Bernard Herrmann has become one of the most imitated composers in the history of cinema. And it's easy to tell when someone is borrowing from him, since his style was very individual. His approach was different from most of his contemporaries, unlike a composer like Henry Mancini, say, who wrote very long and memorable melodies. Herrmann didn't write those kind of tunes in a film score. You don't remember his themes, you remember the color of his music, the choices of the instrumentation. The repeated rhythmic patterns also are very important, what they call ostinatos in music. For example, in Vertigo, think of Carlotta's theme, that Spanish dance called a habanera with that repeated note for harp and those eerie flutes coming in. Or think of the main title with its swirling repeated patterns, obsessively repeated patterns, really. In just a couple of minutes, Herrmann has told you what the entire film is going to be about. It's about obsession. The music can't resolve itself any more than the character of Scotty Ferguson can find his emotional footing in the film. Bernard Herrmann also insisted on doing his own orchestrations to make sure the color of the music was just right. He was very dismissive of the many Hollywood composers who relied on orchestrators. And he was lucky in that he found his own musical voice very early in his life, when he was in his late teens, really. He was born in 1911 in New York City. He studied at Juilliard and New York University, and from the beginning, he was always drawn to iconoclasts in music, people who stood outside the system, who were shaking things up, people like the American composer Charles Ives, who experimented with dissonance, and the Australian Percy Grainger, who was one of his teachers, another person who was very experimental. During the Depression, when most musicians were having a very difficult time making a living, Herrmann found very steady employment and a perfect creative outlet at CBS Radio in New York. He later said that he learned to be a film composer while working in radio, because week after week, he would have to score a new program in just a few days with very little money and often very few musicians. CBS was also the place where, a few years later, Herrmann would meet the man who literally changed his entire professional career, Orson Welles, who was just 4 years his senior. Welles, I think, was about 21 when they met. And despite the many battles they would have over the years, they really were a perfectly suited team. Orson Welles gave Herrmann the freedom to experiment on his radio shows. And it was Wells who really made Herman's film career possible in a single night, the night of October 30th, 1938, when they teamed up on the radio program The War of the Worlds. It was such a sensational broadcast that it gained Wells a film contract, and a contract that gave him total control over whatever film he wanted to make. Johnny. Wells insisted, against studio opinions, on bringing Bernard Herman from New York to Hollywood to score the film, and that film eventually became Citizen Kane. And in his very first film score, Herman really established an unorthodox method of working, well ahead of its time, more common today. He would visit the film set, he would discuss the cues with Orson Welles as the film was being shot. In fact, some of the film was shot to playbacks of the music. Herman always said that the famous finale showing Rosebud was filmed to his music. And unlike many of the wall-to-wall music scores of, say, the late 30s, early 40s, Citizen Kane used many short music cues. Very short themes, typical of Herman, and orchestrations that were very specific to the characters and to the setting. He never used the full orchestra just because it was available, as many composers did. The Citizen Kane score was nominated for an Oscar. Benny lost, but fortunately to his second film score, for the film The Devil and Daniel Webster, also known as All That Money Can Buy. And the same year as that Oscar win, 1942, Bernard Herman met Alfred Hitchcock at the Brown Derby restaurant in Los Angeles. The two men talked about working together, and Benny, as he was known to his friends, was very excited about that, but 13 years would pass before they finally worked together. Why? Well, one reason, I think, was that Hitchcock was working under producer David O. Selznick, and at that time, Selznick really oversaw the music of those films. Hitchcock had very little involvement in the musical decisions. Later, when Hitchcock became his own producer, he did choose the composers. He worked several times with Dmitri Tiomkin, but Tiomkin's work dissatisfied him after a while, and he wanted to look elsewhere. Hitchcock worked with a composer named Lynn Murray on the 1955 film To Catch a Thief, and Lynn Murray was a friend of Bernard Herman. And Mr. Murray later claimed that he suggested his friend Benny for Hitchcock's next film, The Trouble with Harry, and fortunately, Herman and Hitchcock hit it off immediately. They had a very similar artistic sensibility in that they had a shared love of stories about obsessive behavior and characters. They also had a similar sense of humor, which was very useful for a Hitchcock film. In fact, Hitchcock's favorite score of Herman's was The Trouble with Harry, because he felt it perfectly fit the black comedy of the film. And ask any composer, and they will tell you how difficult it is to score a comedy well. Herman also did something few composers had done previously in Hitchcock's films. He really brought out the subtext of the movies. He didn't just play the obvious level of the action, the way I think Tiomkin did in scores like Strangers on a Train. Herman really heightened the psychological underpinnings of the story, which is, I think, why Vertigo and Psycho are two of the most powerful film scores ever written. They managed to heighten the mystery of the story, while at the same time giving you a sense of being inside the characters. Benny would say that the first job of a film composer was to get inside the characters. He also once told an interviewer, and I quote, "Hitchcock only finishes a picture 60%. I have to finish it for him." And although that may sound arrogant, I think that Benny had the breakdown basically correct. The Hitchcock-Herman teaming survived for 11 years, and I say survived because Bernard Herman was not an easy man to work with, and Hitchcock was certainly an opinionated artist, but the two really respected each other a great deal, and for most of their collaboration, Hitchcock would let Herman do exactly what he wanted in the score. Two examples from Vertigo for the climactic love scene in which Judy appears as Madeline once again. Hitchcock wrote in his notes, quote, "When we go to the love scene, we should let all traffic noises fade because Mr. Herman may have something to say here," end quote. Also, in his notes about the rooftop chase that opens the film, Hitchcock outlines his sound plan and then he writes, "All of this will naturally depend upon what music Mr. Herman puts over this sequence." Hitchcock did have one specific suggestion on Vertigo. He tracked down the music for a 1920 stage production of James Barry's play Mary Rose, which was another story of a lost love. He had seen and adored this play in London when he was 21, and he never forgot the score. In his words, it used very effectively a background sound effect, probably a record offstage of eerie music, angels singing and low moaning wind. Well, Bernard Herman didn't use any singing angels in his score, but that quality of sound, that style that Hitchcock describes, can certainly be perceived in the Vertigo score. Bernard Herman makes a musical allusion of his own in Vertigo when he paraphrases a famous musical passage from Wagner's opera, Tristan und Isolde. Now, to be very clear about this, Herman despised musical plagiarism. He was the last person to plagiarize any music. He certainly is not stealing from Wagner. He's making a very sophisticated connection between the story of Vertigo and the story of Wagner's opera and the myth that it's drawn from, which is another story that intertwines love and death and is about a powerful alchemy that brings these two people tragically together. You hear the influence of the Wagner music most clearly in Vertigo's love scene, where Herman's love theme very clearly echoes Wagner's Liebestod, something that means love-death. So the parallel is obvious, since Vertigo is certainly about a man who is in love with someone who is dead. The sequence is also extraordinary for the way that Hitchcock deliberately eliminated dialogue and sound effects and gave Herman the entire soundtrack, something that rarely happens today in film. It shows the tremendous confidence that Hitchcock had in what Herman was going to produce. And Benny was later fond of telling people that Hitch told him at the time, "We'll just have the camera and you."
We were forbidden to play here.
There's another very intelligent use of classical music in Vertigo, one that is a little more obvious. It's the Mozart and Bach that Midge listens to in her apartment and later plays for Scotty, which further links her character to the world of sanity and reason, music that is very organized, classical in the literal sense. And it's very different from the uncontrollable passions that we hear in the music of Bernard Herrmann that speaks for the other characters. One thing you won't find in the music of Vertigo is a theme song, though Paramount Pictures evidently tried to convince Hitchcock to include one, believe it or not. They hired the team of Jay Livingston and Ray Evans, who had written the Oscar-winning song Que Sera Sera for Hitchcock's 1956 film The Man Who Knew Too Much, where the song certainly works very well. This time they wrote a song called, what else, Vertigo. Hitchcock decided not to use it, and I can only imagine Benny's great relief at that. But Herman was frustrated when it came time to record the music because of a musician strike in America. It meant that the music couldn't be recorded in the U.S. with him supervising as he normally did. Instead, it was done in Vienna until the musicians there went out on strike in sympathy, and it was finally finished in London. The conductor in both venues was a British film veteran named Muir Matheson, who'd worked in film for decades. But Herman would always express dissatisfaction with the conducting of the Vertigo score. He thought that Matheson did a sloppy job and that it was filled with mistakes. What is fortunate about the strike situation is that that's the reason we have part of the score in stereo. The Vienna sessions were recorded quite wonderfully in stereo, and fortunately many of the key sequences of the film were done there. You would think listening to this music that Herman felt as passionately about Vertigo as its admirers do. And it was one of his favorite projects, but he did not think the film was perfect by any means. In 1975, he said, and I quote, "They should never have made it in San Francisco, and not with Jimmy Stewart. I don't believe he would be that wild about any woman. It should have been an actor like Charles Boyer. It should have been in New Orleans, or in a hot, sultry climate. When I wrote the picture, I thought of that." Well, nearly 20 years later, Bernard Herrmann got his wish, in a way, when he scored the Brian De Palma film Obsession, which is a partial remake of Vertigo that is set in a hot and sultry climate. And of the two films, Herman actually preferred Obsession. By the way, if you ever see that film again, you'll notice he even quotes from the Vertigo score at one point quite directly for a scene in which Cliff Robertson, who is basically playing the Jimmy Stewart character, is standing at the grave of his lost love. Very few critics in 1958 commented on Vertigo's score, and that inevitably disappointed Herman. He always felt that film music was very overlooked, particularly in America. Years later, he was asked to comment on the film, and he summed up the project by saying, "We liked it, but even in the States, people thought Vertigo was a backache or something." Fortunately, these days, people, I think, are better informed about both the film and the landmark contribution made by the music of Bernard Herman.
And now back to Bob Harris, Jim Katz, and Herbert Coleman.
Can you tell us about the history of the tower shots and the Vertigo shots and things of that sort? I think you told us the first time we spoke, which was maybe 2.5 years ago, that there was some experimentation going on. And
so Herman Roberts, who used to do almost all of my second unit work with me as a head of photography, because we'd tried everything anybody could think of. And Herman said to me, he said, "If you can get me a bomber, one of those bomber bays, you know, that underneath those big bombers," he said.
Like a plastic canopy?
Yeah, that, you know, that round thing that they had a gunner down there in. He said, I've got an idea that might work. So we couldn't find one anywhere, and I asked Jimmy Stewart if he could use his influence, and he did. And we got one, and Herman Roberts had kept using that thing and came up with the idea of backtracking with the camera and changing the focus.
On the zoom?
On the zoom. And that's how they got those effects.
And this is another incredible shot of the match shot, and it's combined with Jimmy walking out downstairs.
There's so much going on in this shot, and yet it looks so static, and you can see the people coming up on looking for the body, and Jimmy Stewart going off. It's quite extraordinary.
There's a story about Jimmy seeing the body falling. Hitch wanted a shot from Jimmy's point of view of the camera going down to the body. So I'd hired had Doc Arrington to get me a big crane with a cage on it. We put the VistaVision camera on it, and we pulled it, had a double lying on the rooftop, and we had lowered this camera very slowly down to this body till it filled the screen, and then backed it up, and had a free fall down to the full length picture of the body. It was the most dangerous thing I ever did. And the way the operator was able to do it is he wrapped white tape around the cable from the part where it had to stop back up the cable from where he started. And he hit that mark exactly every time. We couldn't do it with the camera running slow motion because there were leaves and things moving.
Herbie, this shot was done in the studio, wasn't it?
Right, yes.
Tell us the story about that, because originally you wanted to shoot it, or was it Henry Bumstead wanted to shoot it on location so the light would come in from the sides?
It was always scheduled to be done in the studio. We'd bring all those people up there to do this scene in the actual location when you can build it very cheaply.
One note on the restoration process, the yellow layer fading again can be seen in the restoration, because we used adapted interpositives from the original camera negative, and all of these suits, which were navy blue or gray or black, are all various shades of blue now.
Really?
Some of them actually going to kind of marine blue with clown blue highlights. But the alternative would have been to go to the black and white separations, which did not fit together, were dirty and grainy, and we lost all the highlights in Jimmy's eyes and things like that.
Well,
it's always a toss-up. Do you go for better color, or do you go sharpness and which better represents, although neither can represent perfectly.
Well, you went for the sharpness.
What the cameraman
well,
went
sometimes
to. We went for the sharpness in this shot.
Sometimes we'd go for the color. Sometimes we'd go for the sharpness. It just depended on the sequence. San Francisco, several hours later. You may accept that. Henry Jones is wonderful in this scene.
Yeah, he was very good.
He's the man who everyone hates when this scene comes along. It's the way that he's treating Jimmy Stewart. This was really a different role for Jimmy Stewart.
Do you think the audience has had a tough time accepting him in this role, Herbie?
Jimmy?
Yeah.
Absolutely not. He was believable from the opening scene to the end of it.
Oh, he was totally believable.
Well, he was sort of an icon. I mean, he was really... perceived, I think, by audiences as a totally different person, both through the roles he played and the publicity that was put out on him over the years. And in some of the reviews, they commented on his playing against character or against type in this particular picture. And he rarely did it after this.
He was an amazing actor, you know. He had a tremendous career.
We've reached a verdict.
Thank you. The jury finds that Madeline Elster committed suicide while of unsound mind. Her verdict will be so recorded. Dismissed.
All right, Scotty, let's go. Mind if I speak in a minute?
Oh, go ahead.
The scene with Gavin Elster and Scotty by the window is also important because this was a time Scotty could have gotten away, but Elster very cleverly seduces him once again.
Roped him in again.
Yep.
I'm getting out, Scotty, for good. I can't stay here. I'm going to wind up her affairs and mine, get away as far as I can. Europe, perhaps. Probably never will come back.
Goodbye, Scotty. Is there anything I can do for you before I go? There was no way for them to understand.
There's a shot coming up now, walking to Madeline's grave in the cemetery, for which the camera negative was totally gone. The skies were had gone bright yellow in the in any prints we were able to pull. And we went to the black and white separations, which would not fit together at all. And you can see that even on video, they're going to be soft to a point where the markings on the grave are almost unreadable.
Mr. Coleman explains how he was hired by Alfred Hitchcock on Rear Window.
One evening, the production office called me in and asked me to go out the next morning with the art director, Mac Johnson, to discuss the sets with Mr. Hitchcock. He was doing Dial In for Murder. So we arrived early in the morning out there, and he was rehearsing a scene with Ray Milland and Grace Kelly. And we stood on the side till rehearsal was over, and he came over, and Mac introduced us, and Mr. Hitchcock did offer to shake hands. Of course, he never shook hands with anybody. And I said, it's been rumored around Paramount that you're going to make this picture as you made Rope, One Reel at a Time. And he said, Mr. Coleman, you'll decide how many days I need for the picture when you've written the screenplay. And so then I knew that he had said, send him out here and let me take a look at how he parts his hair. And that was the start of it.
Can we talk about the nightmare sequence a little bit, in which Jimmy is dreaming and the lights are flashing? Were there different versions of this? Were there different cuts? Was it scripted, or did Hitch simply say, go and make me a nightmare sequence? How was this whole thing put together, and the animation also?
The actual screenplay did not contain all the information about, as it usually did, about the way the camera should be used or the lights should be used.
Now, this scene is credited to John Farron.
The main title says Special Sequence by John Farron. And this is the only one we could think of that he might have done.
Mr. Coleman recalls his first day on the set of Rear Window.
The very first day on the production of Rear Window was a shot from Jimmy Stewart's viewpoint of the whole stage. And we had, all together about 150, 200 people. And early in the morning, I had warned all the people that, and most of them knew me because we'd been on pictures together, that I was going to ask for quiet, as I always did. And if people around you didn't respond, would you please turn and say, Herbie has asked for quiet. And so I thought we understood each other. And when Mr. Hitchcock was ready to make the first rehearsal, he had to walk down a long walkway to the lower level to speak to Jessel and Fax. And he was about halfway down. I'd asked for quiet two or three times, and nothing had happened. And all of a sudden, I yelled quiet so loud it shook the stage. And Mr. Hitchcock turned around, looked up to me, and he says, Mr. Coleman, I don't need it quiet. And I said, Mr. Hitchcock, I do. And we became, I guess, friendly from that moment on.
Herbie, how did Hitch feel about the public, and how did the reviews for the film, which were not great when they came out, affect him on a personal basis?
He almost never read the Daily Variety and the Hollywood Reporter. Those were never seen in his office, and he didn't talk very much about the audience's reaction to his films.
Can you discuss a little bit about the flashback sequence being in and out and in and out? I know that from the notes that we got, the printing continuities, that when the negative was cut initially, it was not in the film. It was actually printed as a separate unit and release cut in. But what was going on there with the flashback with, the secret of the story being given away?
Well, I can't believe that's true, that was printed as a separate unit, because if that had been true, we wouldn't have had to bring the prints back from all over the United States of that reel and recut it.
Well, this was for the first few prints, maybe the first half dozen prints.
Oh, I never saw it that way. The first time I ever saw the print, was with the sequence end, and we never had any other idea until Joan Harrison turned out to be the one that came up with the idea that the scene should be out.
Well, it was apparently, it was cut into the prints, but it was physically cut in, but it was not part of the original negative. It was a separate unit at that time.
Did Joan Harrison have his ear? I mean, what was...
Joan and Alma and Hitch had been friends way back in the early days of Hitch's early days in London. And when Hitch came to America, she came along with Alma and Hitch and worked with Alma all the time on the screenplays that of the pictures Hitch did.
And now Mr. Coleman picks up the story of the flashback sequence.
One day I walked in the office in the morning, Hitch was there already, and he said to me, he said, you know, I'm a little worried about having that scene showing when Judy goes into the tower, showing Eldridge throwing his wife's body out. I said, Hitch, what are you talking about? He said, well, I think I'd like to see it with that scene out. I said, Hitch, it's impossible. You'd ruin the picture taking that out. He said, well, I really would like to see it with it out. He said, I said, Hitch, the prints are out all over the United States, ready to go into exhibition. He said, well, still, I'd like to see it. So I told George to take the scene out, and we'd take a look at it, and invited Jimmy and Gloria and Sam Taylor and Suzanne and almost everybody that had been on the picture, and arranged a room for one particular night. And we ran the picture and with that scene out. And when the lights came on, there wasn't a sound in the theater. Not one mumble except Joan Harrison jumped to her feet and yelled, Hitchy, how could anybody want the picture any other ways but this, knowing my feeling about the picture. And I walked over to the side away from everybody and stood there, and Hitch came over and joined me. And I said, Hitch, you can't believe that. And he said, well, I think she's right. And I said, Hitch, look at these people and listen to these people. Not a sound from anybody. That should tell you what they think about it. And we started arguing, and finally he'd had enough of my arguing, and he said, release the picture this way.
Then it went to Paramount, didn't it?
So well, that wasn't Paramount.
No, but then it went to the brass in New York.
Well, I'll go back further, a little further back. Before we cut that out and had that showing, Barney Balaban had come out to the studio and had seen the picture with that sequence in, had gone back to New York raving about this being Hitchcock's very best picture. And then we took that scene out. We had to bring that reel back from everywhere in the country. And Benny had to make changes in the music, but it cost a lot of money, it took a lot of time. And we finally got it back in shape and sent the reels out again. And Barney Balaban had a running for the top critics in New York. And the next day, these critics called Barney Balaban and said, this is not a great Hitchcock picture, it's the worst picture he ever made. And Barney Balaban got on the phone and called us at the studio, demanding to talk to Hitch. And Hitch was up at the ranch. And Balaban said, I want Hitchcock in his office tomorrow, in Jack Karp's office tomorrow morning at 9:00. So I got on the telephone, sent a car up to the ranch. I had him to get tickets for Hitch and Alma at the airport in San Francisco. Then I called Hitch on the phone and told him he had to be in Jack Karp's office the next morning. He said, what about us? I said, something to do about the scene we took out. He said, have you called Lou, meaning Lou Wasserman? I said, no, I haven't. I don't think you should either, Hitch. And so Hitch came in. He had to be in Jack's office at 9:00 the next morning. At 9:18, I looked at my watch. He was standing, and I heard his secretary say, good morning, Mr. Hitchcock, and he didn't answer. And I looked up. He was in the outer office looking through past my secretary's office into my office. And he said, put the picture back the way you had it, and walked into his office. And we didn't speak for about a week. And the picture had to be put back the way it was with the scene in.
Do you think he really believed it was better that way, without that flashback scene in?
No, I don't think so. I think as a matter of fact, after Hitch and I stood there arguing, I walked out past everybody and started from my office, and I heard footsteps, running footsteps, and I stopped, and Jimmy Stewart came running after me and said, "Herbie, you should not get so angry at Hitch. He's not worth it." I said, "Was I right? Was Hitch right?" He said, "You were right." I said, "Well, why didn't you speak up, Jimmy? You know what respect he has for your opinion." And Jimmy said, "It's not worth it, Herbie." So he said, "Come on, let's go chase it for dinner. It's not with me."
Well, that scene going in and out was basically our nemesis on this restoration, because in order to duplicate the shots of going into the tower, etc., in the 50s, you had to go from the original camera negative to what are called black and white separation masters, which are three filtered black and white positives, which basically capture the spectrum of color. And then you make a new dupe negative from those. And what they had to do was go from the camera negatives to the, all in VistaVision, the camera negatives to black and white masters, separations, and then to dupe negatives, combining the scene that you'll see in a moment of Jimmy at the door, camera moving to Judy, the screen getting darker, then going to the flashback, and then coming back out again and dissolving. And the two dissolves are part of this, which were unbalanced in 1958. They weren't done totally perfectly. But the problem is that the dupe negative faded. And by the time we got it, and it was cut into the original VistaVision negative, although it was a dupe, it was a third generation element, that unit provided picture that was basically blue and orange. We could do nothing with it. And the black and white separation masters that were made on the entire picture included that section as a dupe of a dupe. And once you go through two sets of black and white separations, you have total corruption of the color, green the size of golf balls. And those separations were fourth generation. And we had to take those separations, which were the only thing that survived. The original negative elements were either in other parts of the film or junked, and produce a VistaVision dupe negative from the masters, and a VistaVision interpositive from those, which was sixth generation, and then a 65mm dupe negative,
my goodness,
which was seventh generation, and the 70mm prints are eighth generation. And the majority of this transfer is being made from a 65mm interpositive, which is produced from the restoration negative. But we're trying to go back two generations on that sequence and just clean it up a little bit for the video transfer by going off of a Vista element. But in the new stocks, it doesn't make that much of a difference, since the stocks are so good, and all of the damage was really done by the time that the second set of separation masters were done in the fourth generation element.
In order not to disturb the eye of the audience, the picture will gradually go from the eight generations back down to four, with a stop in the middle.
At six,
so yeah. That when she touches the gray suit in the closet, you can see a little bump in there, which brings it back to the level that we'd been viewing for most of the picture.
And you can see that in the reconstructed print?
Yes, well, you can.
Yeah, you can see.
But going into it, we jump from fourth generation to eighth generation, and we discussed it, and it's one of those situations where, you know, we've been saying for years the problems with Eastman color negatives, and I think it's part of public awareness, and it's the one area where we basically wanted it to show through a little bit, and it's the degradation of the negative element, and it's the one point where the audience really gets to see the difference between a restored image and something off just a plain surviving element.
Well, I've been on blind dates before. Matter of fact, to be honest, I've been picked up before.
We could have used some digital technology to help it a bit, but as it turns out, the costs are astronomical and relative.
There's the dupe cutting in right there.
That's the shot, yeah. But the cost of the digital technology at about $1,000 a frame, we figured that we were better off leaving it the way it was, as sort of a reminder to people as to what can happen to these films and what this film would have looked like in a year or two all the way through. And the improvement wouldn't have been that great digitally, so we decided to leave it.
Yeah, well, you can see when the dupe first comes on, as you look in the highlights in Kim's eyes, they're not duplicated, but duplicated twice. They're all over the place.
How did Kim handle the transformation of the characters? I mean, was she...
It was amazing.
Was she different when she had the dark hair as opposed to the light hair? On the set, when you talked to her, was...
No. As a matter of fact, she was rather a recluse. She didn't mix very much with the people.
This particular costume that she's wearing, we have in our office, and we used it as a color reference. And it was really strange because everybody who came into the office wanted to try it on.
Kim Novak.
From my point of view, when I first read those lines of where she says, I want you to love me for me, you know, and all, talking in that scene, I just identified it with so much because, you know, going to Hollywood as a young girl and all, suddenly finding that they want to make you over totally. It's like they... You know, it's such a total change. And it was like I was always fighting to show some of myself, feeling that I wanted to be there as well. And it was like they'd do my hair or makeup, and I'd go back in the back room and redo a bunch of things. And it was like, so I really identified with the fact of someone that was being made over with the resentment, with wanting to, because needing approval and wanting to be loved. And willing eventually to go to any lengths to get that, you know, by changing her hair and all of these different things. And then of course when Judy appears, it's another story. And then when she has to go through that change, I really identified with the movie, because to me it was saying, please, I mean, see who I am, you know, fall in love with me. There was nothing make-believe or phony about Jimmy Stewart from the minute he walked on. And that, for me, was the most comforting thing. So assuring. I felt so assured, knowing that he was there. He was a great support, just a great support. All he'd have to do is reach out and touch my hand, and I'd feel energized with love and trust, you know? And so he's just a simple, beautiful, true, honest human being. He has all the qualities that anyone could ever want in a man. I do recall one story that I thought was interesting, because Hitch would write some scenes that I didn't quite understand. I didn't understand how they got from A to B or C to D. And I asked him, and he said, no, in a mystery, you never want to reveal. You never want to show exactly how you arrived at something. And I said, but yes, but there's a scene that bothers me. It doesn't make sense. And he said, that's the point, my dear. That's the point, you know. It was as if something shouldn't add up, and that will help evoke and let the audience participate more. Hitch had a wonderful way of not having things, not wanting things to add up exactly, so that you couldn't keep score and say, well, if she goes to A and B, you will naturally, well, C will be expected. I mean, he loved to move things around and not always totally justify a scene on purpose, to keep the audience alert and to keep them participating. And that was really important for him. Hitch just really wanted you to work as you're watching it just as much and be involved in it. So he'd make things make sense, but at the same time, there were often things that didn't. There were some scenes he said, it really doesn't matter, really doesn't matter.
Henry Bumstead, art director.
You know, Hitch worked with a writer in his office, and he went over everything. And in Hitch's mind, he might suggest color now and then to me, but it was basically my color. And of course, I talked colors over with Bob Burks. You know, I've always tried to stay close to the cameraman. They can cause you a lot of problems if they get in a set and they don't like the color of it, you know, and then the company is held up. And I think maybe my second picture that I did, well, that would be Vertigo. And Hitch was sitting in his chair, and I was sitting next to him, and the lip was out, and he was frowning. And I said, Hitch, what are you thinking about? And Hitch's reply was, I'm thinking about my next film. This is terribly boring. Now, he had that picture so well in his mind, he really resented, and many times he told me, he resented the time it took to light a set, and that like the cameraman would have 4 or 5 hours with the actors, and he has 2. Because Hitch never started filming before 9. It was marvelous. Of course, I could go into the studio at 6 o'clock in the morning, and I could get all my work done and still be over there when Hitch arrived on the set. And then he always went home early. You know, 5:30, got his day's work, and so I think Hitch, I think every film he did, he was very much into it, and because I say, you know, it's not like somebody gave him a script. He had worked for maybe weeks or months on this script, and he knew every scene in it. And you know, to substantiate that, he never went to dailies. Hitch never went to dailies. And I asked him once, and he says, I was sitting by the camera, I saw what I got. He says, why do I have to go to dailies? The only time he would ever look at it, anything, was maybe if there was a problem in the print or in the lighting, you know, then he might come and look to see whether it was okay or not. And then many times he would bring Alma, his wife. He listened to her, you know. If Alma said it was okay with Hitch. And it was a collaborative venture between the two of them. Hitch always had certain things on each film that he was adamant about. And I think that's when maybe a picture, two or three times during the picture, certain scenes, he would make a rough sketch, which I still have some, fortunately. And he wanted this or that, and they were very rough, believe me. So I would do just what he said, only I would elaborate on it, and of course, make it much more sophisticated, much better than what he drew. Because, you know, Hitch was an art director at one time, back at UFA. He did do that. And as I said, the rest of the picture was up to you. He didn't want to go look at locations, and I remember on Vertigo, and I had this big tower set and everything, you've got, 100 people working and this and that, and they all come to the stage in the morning, and if things aren't right, what do, you know, if he doesn't like it? So I told Herbie Coleman, I said, and I was working on the set right to the last minute, I said, would you ask Hitch if he'd come over here tonight? So pretty soon Herbie returns. Herbie was a producer, and he said, I asked Hitch if he wanted to look at your set, and he turned to me and he says, is Bummy a professional? And Herbie said, well, yeah. He says, well, then why do I have to look at the set? That was it. So as I said, I was very lucky he came in and liked it, so I crossed another hurdle. When you did try to show Hitch sets, if you ever did get him on location, you always arrived late, and then you had a big lunch, and then there was no time to look at sets. So you would have to show him something on the way back to the airport, and you would ask the driver to slow down, and you'd say, Hitch, now look over on the right, that Gothic building, and the head would go like that, and that would, oh, he'd say, that's fine, along those lines, Mummy, you know. So I mean, it was. Although I did take pictures and showed him.
I love the second one she wore, and this one, it's beautiful. No.
Herbert Steinberg, former Paramount director of advertising and publicity.
During Vertigo, I was the director of advertising publicity at Paramount Studios. And when Hitchcock started the film, I assigned the unit publicity man, the unit publicist, and I also supervised the photography, the still photography, so that we would have the material to advertise and publicize the picture when it was released. And so I had almost daily conversations with Hitch to tell him what we were doing and how we were approaching the picture. And of course, he had a brilliant advertising and publicity mind. He had been an art director. He drew beautifully. And so he was very helpful. He would actually sketch some of the things that we photographed. Hitchcock had a say in the marketing of the film in that he designated San Francisco as the place to premiere it. He designated who he would like to have there for the opening, who would lend most to the publicity of the film. And he also was very, very helpful in the design of the advertising, the unique, like the vortex theme that ran through the advertising. And that was Hitch's innovation. Hitch's favorite restaurant in San Francisco was Ernie's. And of course, when he came in, they treated him like royalty. So we had the post-premiere party there at Hitch's insistence. And they turned everything out like you can't believe. They had all of his favorite dishes. They had caviar, they had champagne, and of course, Hitch's wine. And the press just had a wonderful time, largely because it was a good movie and there was nothing to cover. And they just, the party reflected the mood that was left by the movie. It was one of the more successful post-premiere parties of its time. As far as the studio was concerned, Hitchcock could have called the picture the bird on Nellie's hat. They weren't going to argue with him. You just didn't argue with Hitchcock. Once he set his sights on something, that's what he wanted. You know, they were just so happy to get a Hitchcock picture in the can. They went along with what Hitchcock wanted. Hitch was not difficult. As a matter of fact, among all of the personalities that I worked with over the years, directors, writers, producers, actors, actresses, he was as cooperative and as understanding of what your job was. And as long as you did your job professionally, he went right along with you. In the later years, I had lunch with him every Friday in his private office. We went to Boston one day. This was on a tour that we did, 11-city tour with a private jet. And to tell you how dedicated he was to doing what you thought was good for the movie, we selected 10 cities in the United States. We hired this jet, private jet. It was just he and I in the jet and the pilots. And we flew from to Dallas, Atlanta, Washington, New York, Boston, Chicago, St. Louis, Denver, 10 cities. And we would set him up in the morning in a set and invite the television people, the television critics, in to set up their own interview. We had one camera, and we just put different cassettes in each time, and he went through as many as 10, 12 interviews a day. It took a period of about 12 days. We finally got to Boston, and we got in kind of late. There's a restaurant in Boston called Jimmy's at the Pier. I don't know whether it's still there or not. And they knew Hitch. He had been there before. And we literally opened the restaurant at about 10 o'clock at night. They opened it for him so that he would have dinner. And they served him fish. He liked fish. They served him fish, and when it was all over, Hitch said, "What kind of fish was that?" And they said, "It's gray sole." Well, he had been eating Dover sole most of the time, but this was very, very good. He arranged for a shipment of gray sole to come in from Boston every Friday morning on American Airlines. He sent his driver out to pick up the package in ice, bring it to the studio where they would prepare it the way he liked it prepared, and we would have gray sole for lunch every Friday. This went on for years. With his shoestring potatoes, which he picked up with his hand, put on his plate, and his little glass of wine. It was just amazing. He was that casual and that warm when you got to know him.
Patricia Hitchcock O'Connell, daughter of Alfred Hitchcock, and Alma Reville.
Well, The thing I think I remember most was the opening of Vertigo up in San Francisco. We had it up there because of Ernie's restaurant, and they became very close friends of ours. It was actually a little, rather a sad period, too, because my mother had been taken to the hospital and had been diagnosed with cancer. Luckily, a very, if there is such a thing, a minor form, and fully recovered. But my father was sort of a basket case that whole time, so it was a little nerve-wracking trying to keep everything serene and calm at the opening of Vertigo up in San Francisco. My mother was involved with my father's pictures from the word go. She had been actually in the business longer than he had. They met in England, and she was already working in pictures, and he was doing the titles, drawing the titles for silent movies. As a result, when he became a director and was able to pick his own stories, he would either find a book or a story. The first person to read it would be my mother. If my mother didn't think it made a movie, then he never touched it. If she thought it had possibilities, he would then have a treatment written. And early on, she did work on a lot of the treatments. And then she would be involved in the selections of the writer and even, to quite an extent, the cast. So she had a tremendous amount of input. And in fact, when she died, Charles Chaplin said about her, he said the Hitchcock touch had four hands and two of them were Alma's. I think he was just trying to make a very good movie, which is exactly what he did with every other movie. I think today people want to see things in his pictures. And he says that's wonderful. My oldest daughter took a course on him when she was at college, and she would go back to him and say, now, Grandpa, they said that in such a movie you use the number 7 and this, that, and the other, and, you know, is that true? And she says, no, Mary, I was just trying to make a movie. But he says that's the whole thing, is that let people get from a movie what they want. Not everybody is going to see every movie the same way. And that was fine with him. He didn't mind, you know, anybody delving in, shall we say. He just wanted to make a movie that would be enjoyable to everybody. And that's, you know, what happened. When Vertigo first came out, I don't think it was the success that my father hoped it was going to be, either financially or critically. It seems that it's only been in the, I would say the last maybe 20 years, that it really has come into its own, so to speak. I think people are seeing things in it, which, as he said, that's wonderful. Everybody that buys a ticket to a movie can see whatever they want to see in the movie. And I think that's the fascinating thing. And it's fascinating to me that this is almost, not a cult, but it's fascinating to see how people now think this is a marvelous movie when they didn't really think it was at the time.
Peggy Robertson, script supervisor.
Hitch said to me once that his definition of happiness was a clear horizon. There was no clouds. He hated arguments. He'd never get into arguments. If he said something, he wanted something, it would be carried out. If he wanted, I'm talking about the set now, not the personal life. Personal life was as happy and blissful as one can imagine. Hitch and Alma and their daughter Pat were just a wonderful family. Working with him was wonderful because he knew exactly what he wanted. Every shot, we had a sketch of every camera movement, and this was circulated to everyone who was in charge of sound man got a copy, the camera operator, the lighting photographer. Everyone had a copy of what the shots were going to be so they could all prepare in advance, so there was no excuse for waste of time. You had to know your job, you had to know what you were doing. But he was just wonderful. Everyone adored him. We used to talk about him incessantly. After shooting, we'd go across to have a drink or just to sit around and talk about him. And talk to him with the families too. With our husbands and wives, we'd discuss him. You know what he said today? We'd tell the jokes. It was a wonderful atmosphere. As he said himself, He never worked with horrible people. He always had nice people around, and the crew members were wonderful. Everyone worked together. We were all working for the same purpose, to get a good film. Jimmy Stewart was a wonderful actor for Hitch to work with, one of his very, very favorite ones. Hitch, right from the beginning, loved Jimmy. They were friends to begin with. He was a complete professional in his job. He always came on the set learning his lines. He knew his lines. He knew what he was supposed to do. He knew what his part was. Anything he had to say, he would whisper to Hitch, and vice versa, Hitch would whisper to him.
And now back to Bob Harris, Jim Katz, and Herbert Coleman.
We should get into this scene a little bit, where he's taking her back to the mission.
We had a lot of problems with this scene, technically. What you're looking at now is fourth generation, obviously, with the match shot. This is all fourth generation. Actually, starting with this shot, we are in. We're still working off the camera negative with adjusted gamma, and we go for only two or three shots. And then when we hit the shot of the tower, the close up of the tower, we go to the black and white separations. And
for the rest of the film.
For the rest of the film, literally. And as it worked, basically with all the studios until the last two or three years, actually. Separations would be produced, paid for, and vaulted, and never, ever looked at or checked. And we're dealing with separations here that are totally defective. The first half of the ending, the gamma is too high, which is yielding a much higher than normal contrast. And you'll actually see things like Jimmy Stewart's collar shining. This is the first shot off of black and white separations. From here on, the rest of the film is off of black and white set masters, but his collar is glowing, and the contrast is much too high. It's almost like the orthochromatic look of Al Jolson's gloves in The Jazz Singer. And then you get about halfway in, and I'll tell you precisely when it occurs, that we go to the third section of separations, or actually the second section of separations, in this role, because they're short units, and the gamma is then too low, and it's very, very flat, and we had problems there, and we've tried to adjust it on video, and you can hide a number of sins on video, which you can't photographically, but I think you'll still be able to see where there are problems with the contrast and matching between the two sections here.
Do you think the theater audience would ever see that?
A lot of people would, or some people
would,
certainly.
If we don't try to do the best possible job and put up the best that we can from the materials that are available, sure, the audience might not catch every nuance.
But we see it.
I'm sure that no one ever accused you of being careless with what you were doing, because it's all so beautiful when you see it.
Well, they're worrisome to us, and, you know, dubbing this in the Hitchcock Theater, we're dealing with a lot of ghosts, and we have a responsibility to the memory of people and, you know, the actors who are still around. And
we had some projection problems in New York and a few around in Washington, and Pat said, it's just my father having a little joke. But this scene here, as they're going up the tower, was sort of controversial in the restoration, because we've been accused by a few critics of making it too dark. And by checking the notes and checking various...
Checking the 1958 prints.
The prints as well.
It was very dark.
Oh, yes, we intended it to be dark.
Well, it basically showed only flickers of her earring, as you could see
on
there.
A couple of shots, yeah.
And he wanted only to see the necklace and the earring sparkle, see bits of Jimmy's shirt, and as they passed the portals, you could see a little bit of the moonlight outside.
And then you can see a little bit more, but this is the scene where we go to the other separations, and you'll notice we're trying to fix it in video as we can, but it is a lower contrast image.
And it should be dark, because it... the violence is implied, and it's much more moving and much more dramatic by not seeing anything. Probably today we would see her hair messed up and bruises on her face and a torn dress and torn stockings, and yet it's sort of very Japanese in a way.
I don't think we wanted to see those things.
Oh, no, we no, don't.
But,
we don't.
But if this film was being made today, I'm afraid that's what we would see. It just works so well, the way it was shot and the way it plays in the dark.
One of the interesting things to me about this scene is that the performances are so unbelievable.
Oh, yeah.
They were apparently the best that were obtained, and these scenes are actually not out of focus, but the action is not in focus. The background is in focus. And Hitch must have made the selection and said, we're going to go with it this way.
And he's solving the crime. We're seeing her being pulled up to the tower, and he's getting over his vertigo. I mean, there's so much happening in this trip up the tower that it's incredible, and builds to the unbelievable crescendo.
Getting back to the scene being dark, and a couple of critics mention it. It's interesting that,
now, this leg shot was also very important.
It's interesting that looking at it on video, on the old videos, it's very bright. It's almost like people in the 70s and 80s were afraid of making something dark on a TV screen, or it couldn't be made dark enough. But a lot of critics must have seen it either on video or in reissue, where it was wrong. The reissue of Man Who Knew Too Much, when the prints were made, they left out all the fade-outs and fade-ins.
There was a critic who commented on it, and we take this personally, Herbie, you know, and we...
Now, this is a critic that for whom we have great respect, and...
We sent him some clips from the...
From a 1958 die transfer print.
Which showed how in some frames were completely black.
Now, he criticized being so dark?
Dark.
Dark, yeah.
He thought it was dark.
He didn't...
Because that's what we wanted. We went for that.
Well, they keep talking about an alternate ending, Herbie, but we like to call it an extended ending that we found as we were going through the negative of the picture. Do you remember anything about that?
You mean the elders being convicted of murder and all that sort of thing?
Yeah, it was a very simple shot. And it was just in Midge's apartment, we heard that Gavin Elster was apprehended. Now, this is one of the most dramatic endings to a picture.
Oh, yeah.
And so...
Now, this was Sam Taylor's idea.
Really?
Yep.
And it was so different. I mean, this was so...
I mean, the bell tolling.
That's a brilliant idea.
He's a brilliant writer.
Well, I think after seeing it, it was definitely worth the 2.5 years or so we put into it. And
yep.
To see it with an audience today is really satisfying, and to keep the memory of Hitchcock alive.
And I think we should thank you, Herbie, for all the work that you did on the picture.
I did very little. I answered the telephone a few times.
Is that what it was?
Well, thanks for answering the telephone, Herbie. We appreciate it.
I was happy to do it, and I'm especially happy now after having seen what you've done with the picture.
Commentary credits. MCA Universal Home Video, Executive in Charge of Production, Colleen A. Benn. Produced by Laurent Bouzereau. Edited by Pete Knazer, Image Entertainment. In addition to those featured in the commentary, we also wish to thank Harrison Engel and Signal Hill Entertainment, Andrew London, Michelle Montanez, Joseph McBride, Marlene Noble, Jeffrey Saxon, Pacific Ocean Post, and Chase Productions, Inc.